A very warm welcome to our morning service. This is the 10th Sunday after Trinity. We hear this morning of Jesus cleansing the temple of money changers and those selling cattle, sheep and doves. The words from Jesus, however, could not be clearer. My Father's house is a house of prayer. Let us always remember this. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and with thy spirit. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. And we say together, Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely this, Thou shalt love thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee. Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and power infinite, have mercy upon the whole church, and so rule the heart of thy chosen servant, Elizabeth, our Queen and Governor, that she, knowing whose minister she is, may above all things seek thy honour and glory, and that we and all her subjects, duly considering whose authority she hath, may faithfully serve, honour and humbly obey her, in thee and for thee, according to thy blessed word and ordinance, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Let thy merciful ears, O Lord, be open to the prayers of thy humble servants, and that they may obtain their petitions, make them to ask such things as shall please thee. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The lesson is taken from Jeremiah chapter 7, beginning at the 9th verse. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, make offerings to Baal, and go after other gods that you have not known, and then come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, We are safe, only to go on doing these abominations? Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your sight? You know I too am watching, says the Lord. Go now to my place that was in Shiloh, where I made my name dwell at first, and see what I did to it for the wickedness of my people Israel. And now, because you have done all these things, says the Lord, and when I spoke to you persistently, you did not listen, and when I called you, you did not answer. Therefore, I will do to the house that is called by my name, in which you trust, and to the place that I gave to you and all your ancestors, just what I did to Shiloh. And I will cast you out of my sight, just as I cast out all your kinsfolk, all the offspring of Ephraim. As for you, do not pray for this people. Do not raise a cry or prayer on their behalf. And do not intercede with me, for I will not hear you. Do you not see what they are doing in the towns of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem? Here endeth the lesson.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 19th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, beginning at the 41st verse. Glory be to thee, O Lord. As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you, and they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God. Then he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling things there. And he said, It is written, My house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. Every day he was teaching in the temple. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. Let us proclaim our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. It probably dates me to say that, as a child, both my brother and I were taught to say our prayers before going to bed. Before we got into bed, we were required to kneel at our bedside and say the following prayer. Gentle Jesus, meek and mild, look upon a little child. Pity my simplicity and suffer me to come to thee. Amen. We were not always very keen on saying our prayers, and as such, both my brother and I both learnt to say the prayer at breakneck speed. We also knew how to say it slowly, or indeed demand to say our prayers when we wanted to delay getting into bed. But as far as Jesus himself was concerned, it sent a very clear message to us from an early age, that Jesus was a man who was meek and mild. I don't think that either of us gave much thought as to the character reference when we said our prayers. However, the prayer has stayed with me all my life, and always seems to surface when I read about the cleansing of the temple. Where is the gentle Jesus, meek and mild, in this story? The account we've just heard in Luke's Gospel is relatively benign, and you could be excused for not paying it much attention. However, the account of the same event in John's Gospel is much more disturbing. Indeed, it is depicted for you on the front of your service sheets. In John's Gospel, we learn that Jesus made a whip of cords and then drove out those people selling cattle, sheep, and doves before pouring out the coins of the money changers and overturning their tables. Today, he could be lawfully apprehended by the church wardens. He could also have been charged with affray and criminal damage. Despite this account, we generally don't like to think of either God or his Son being angry. But the Bible tells us something different. In the Old Testament, God not only gets angry, but his anger almost continually burns against someone or something. In the book of Exodus, God's anger burned against Moses for showing reluctance to lead God's people. Subsequently, his anger was kindled against the Israelites when they complained about their misfortunes in the wilderness. And we repeatedly hear from the prophets, from Isaiah to Malachi, expressions of God's anger against his people. The prophet Nahum asks, "Who can endure the heat of God's anger? Who indeed?" I am tempted to say like father, like son, but Jesus' anger is also evident in the New Testament. At the beginning of Mark's Gospel, we hear the story of Jesus healing the man with the withered hand. When the Pharisees questioned him about healing on the Sabbath, we learn that Jesus looked around at them with anger. And when he cleansed the temple, we hear from John's Gospel that as well as driving out the money changers, he shouted at them, "Take those things out of here. Stop making it a marketplace." However, what are we to make of an angry Jesus? Some people have tried to explain the anger exhibited by Jesus by suggesting that it represents the eschatological force of his second coming. As the book of Revelation tells us, when Jesus comes again to earth, we will all encounter the wrath of the Lamb. And perhaps the cleansing of the temple is just a foretaste. I am not totally convinced by this explanation, and perhaps we can simply assume instead that it is not always wrong to get angry. Indeed, we would not be fully human if we were not angered by such things as cruelty, deceit, injustice or mistreatment, or indeed profaning God's temple. If God is angered by these things, then, just like his Son, perhaps we too should be angered in such circumstances. But some go even further and suggest that the gospel of Jesus Christ should make us angry. And if it doesn't, there is probably something wrong with us. Archbishop Oscar Romero said about preaching the gospel that it should be a preaching that awakens, as when a light is turned on and annoys the sleeper. That is the preaching of Christ. Wake up, be converted. That is the church's authentic teaching. Such preaching must meet conflict, spoil what is miscalled prestige, must disturb. The vocations website of the Roman Catholic Church follows in a similar vein, telling aspiring priests as follows: a priest is unlikely to have to repeat Jesus' cleansing of the temple, but his words will demand the overturning of people's lives. And the website goes on: the words of the gospel demand a radical transformation of the way we think, act, and live. The priest's ministry includes a full presentation of the church's social teaching, taking seriously the gospel as a message of freedom, of liberation from everything that oppresses God's people. Anyone who fights against oppression, lay or ordained, is bound, in my view, to both feel and express anger. Unfortunately, this demand for action puts us at odds with other advice in the Bible. St. Paul says we must get rid of anger and put away all anger and wrangling. And in the light of this, how can we get angry at all? But by contrast, I often find myself exasperated by the Anglican Church and its seeming indifference. It's as if the Church of England exists to be the nation's referee rather than a player on the pitch. I sometimes say to myself, get off the fence and say something. Be angry. As one commentator put it, Jesus is not the benign ecumenical Christ of perpetual reconciliation that is forever meek and mild, graciously asking Mr. Money Changer, "Excuse me, sir, but would you be so kind as to move your tables outside, because this is a house of prayer, bless you." "My gentle Jesus, meek and mild," was our mantra before the lights were put out each night. But when the light of the gospel was finally switched on, a very different Jesus emerged. Amen.
Oh,
And let us pray. Let us pray for the whole state of Christchurch militant here in earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications, and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, and specially thy servant Elizabeth, our queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed, and grant unto her whole council and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and impartially minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and specially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other kind of adversity. And we remember particularly this morning the people of Afghanistan, embroiled once again in war. We pray for those who have been killed, those who have been injured, those who have been captured, and those who mourn. And we pray that the Prince of Peace might reign in that land. And we pray for refugees, particularly those fleeing war across the globe. We pray for those who are persecuted, those who have been tortured, those who seek sanctuary, and those who seek to help them. We pray for our own parish. We pray for those who are unwell, those receiving treatment in hospital, those who are unwell at home, and those who suffer in silence and are known only to Almighty God. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear. We remember those whose anniversary falls this week, and we beseech thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. As our Saviour Christ has commanded and taught us, we are bold to say together, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with thy spirit. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.